Maserati Levante is a high-performance luxury ride that goes 0 to 100 kilometers an hour in just 5.2 seconds, has a top speed of 264 kph, and comfortably fits five. Today, the machine is built in Turin, Italy. Yet its heritage was born a 3.5 hour drive into the heart of the country. Welcome to Modena, an ancient city situated in the heart of the Emilia-Romagna region of northern Italy. In a land of antiquity, it's a place unlike any other.
In 100 kilometers, maybe a little bit more, you have Lamborghini, Ferrari, Maserati, Ducati, even Dallara. This area is full of artisans working on the automotive, so this becomes a specialty region.
Commonly known as La Terra di Motiri, or Motor Valley, this area is the crucible of speed.
I think it's innate. We have it inside us. We have always made them. It can't be an accident that all of the great brands of sports cars come from right here in Italy. Torino, Modena, Maranello, just to name a few. Sant'Agata Bolognese, motorcycles, other brands.
The build begins when a fully functional Range Rover arrives from the Solihull factory.
It's a complete vehicle, and it comes into this facility, and we'll then take parts out and refit new parts, or we'll modify parts. So we'll add new options onto the vehicle, essentially.
Basically, it's only another dream that that car is bespoke and it's theirs, nobody else's.
It's a quiet, artisanal workshop where nothing is rushed.
They're going to be building an autobiography build on this car, so there's quite a lot involved. Bumpers off, seats out, change the console with champagne coolers in. Nice little touches here, there, all over the car, really.
The bespoke conversion takes two craftspeople roughly 5.5 hours.
Probably 50-ish parts, something like that. So some are obviously quite large, like the center console, and then the coats are really small, so.
We're seeing a huge shift in the entire automotive industry that went from hand-built cars very early on to mass production. Mass production means that the companies get to survive, but it also means you as a consumer don't have anything different than anyone else. I think it's genius that all of these car companies are recognizing that small, one-off stuff is way more special to people in the luxury market.
Luxury clientele that are as much fanboys as anything else.
All sorts of people, obviously people with money, sports, superstars, car enthusiasts, lottery winners. And the nice thing is we get to see them. They'll come in themselves and watch us building their car. It's nice to know that the car you're building for somebody, they want to come and watch you build it.
Customers aren't the only ones who recognize the difference.
It's more take your time, get it for the right first time. No rushing around sort of thing.
It's in your blood after a while. It's a great pleasure, great pleasure.
There's not many about. If you're lucky enough to have one, then it'll select you, really.
In a sea of similar-looking SUVs, the G-Wagon stands out thanks to its unique proportions and boxy stance.
The G-Class became an icon because it looks the same as it always has and can do anything. I can drive this vehicle up into the mountains, I can take it to the opera, I can drive to a restaurant and I will always be noticed. It's amazing. It goes anywhere.
Remember, luxury has a lot of different meanings. For some people, luxury is Rolls-Royce. For other people, it's just, I want something cool that I don't see anywhere else. Well, something that looks like a brick driving down the street is completely different.
Today, the G-Class is considered a symbol of luxury. Yet when the machine originally is conceived, that's not the intention. The saga starts in 1973, thanks to a very personal request.
The Shah asked for a vehicle that was able to provide border patrol in his huge country. So that was the initial, let's say, spark that ignited the whole story.
The Shah is the Shah of Iran, and in the early 70s, he's a major shareholder in Mercedes-Benz. He asks the company to build an off-road military 4x4.
Well, there's only a handful of SUVs that have military backgrounds, and G-Wagon's one of them.
Initially, the brand is hesitant. At the time, no one understands the potential of the SUV segment. But when the Shah places an order for 20,000 machines, the brand is compelled to act. Royalty has that sort of pull. 2 years later, the machine is finally ready to test. They prove the powertrain in an indoor off-road laboratory. Then crunch the suspension with massive hydraulic posts. And finally, crash the entire machine to prove its structural integrity.
It starts when we put a simple barcode on the bumper beam of the underbody, and then it works its way through the line, having all the parts applied to it.
They've been building aluminum cars for a while, and they're into the lightweight benefits that that provides.
The use of aluminium differentiates Jag, while also hiding a powerful eco-secret. One-third of the machine's weight is comprised of recycled metal.
We also use an awful lot of recycled aluminium in our products, and 80% of all aluminium that's been produced around the world is still in use today, so it's a fantastic material for us to use.
The use of recycled aluminium helps the F-Pace shave weight, but also saves the planet. Reusing the metal requires 95% less energy than producing it from scratch.
We're in our underbody area at the moment, so we have the front of the underbody, the middle section, and the rear end.
Each body shell is comprised of 354 individual parts, and each one is riveted and glued.
Robots in the facility is total, which apply 2,600 rivets using 300 rivet guns.
The rivets hold the pieces in place, but it's the 153 meters of adhesive that actually join the parts together.
So we have rivets that hold the part in position, and the adhesive that gives it the structural integrity.
With the underbody completed, it's time to add the side panels. They start with the inner structural components.
The underbody now has come into the first framing station, and the body side inners will be applied by the robot.